Oh, I want to be an architect.
Be it horse, cat, human, or even lizard, our lives are but the briefest flashes in a universe that is billions of years old.
See, Sarah Lynn? We're not doomed. In the great grand scheme of things, we're just tiny specks that will one day be forgotten. So it doesn't matter what we did in the past or how we'll be remembered. The only thing that matters is right now, this moment, this one spectacular moment we are sharing together. Right, Sarah Lynn? Sarah Lynn?
I think it started when I was a kid. Maybe 10, maybe 11. I can't remember exactly. That don't really matter. What really matters is that it was at a point in my life where, like most of us, most of my thoughts were either unrestrained or stubborn. I would lie on the top of the bunk bed I shared with my cousins in the chaotic mess that we called a bedroom and think about life. Actually, life isn't deep enough. Thinking back now, what I was really interested in was existence. You know, like, why does anything matter? Sitting alone, contemplating to the soundtrack of my cousin snoring beneath me, I'd wonder, in this whole wide universe, my families, my faith, my ambition, why does it matter? Our goals, our dreams, our achievements, our triumphs, our tragedies. Eventually, we all die, and the world continues to rotate indifferently. From reading The Alchemist to watching Rick and Morty, the question always comes up. Why does our life matter? Let me be clear, not why does life matter, but why do our lives matter? Me and you, our specific individual lives in the grand scheme of everything. Can you tell me? I'd actually be interested to know your thoughts in the comments below. But anyway, for me, the answer came from an unusual place. It came on a starry night in an empty field, brought to life by the glow of 1,000 tiny fireflies. Firstly, I want to say, it probably would have been easier to turn to countless centuries of religious doctrine and conflicting arguments to answer this question. I'm sure some of you will find passages in the Bible, the Quran, the Torah, etc. to summarize it all. And there's nothing wrong with that. But honestly, I'd be blatantly lying if I said I was tempted by the idea. The backlash, the comments, and the never-ending drone of YouTube scholars, I'm not on it. So I'll leave that for someone more qualified. Also, I was raised under the teaching of two main religions. I spent the early part of my childhood taking pilgrims to the local churches to immerse myself in the teachings of Christianity, and then later, tongues was translated into Arabic as the comprehensive, distinctive principles of Islam was introduced to my life. One thing that experience has taught me is that our spiritual ambitions and our worldly ambitions are brothers. They meet in this Cain and Abel-inspired limbo where they either want to hug, laugh, fight, and sometimes kill each other. Which means that answering the question of our higher spiritual purpose doesn't always leave us satisfied when trying to identify our more practical ones. So we chase ambitions, dreams, and ideas, only to be left with the practical question. Why does it matter? Maybe because of fireflies. Let me explain. I was 6 years old when I saw a firefly for the first time. It was 1994. I'd been living in Ghana for a year, very much removed from London, the land of fish and chips, moody bus drivers, and the confines of my family home in Tottenham. The night I saw my first firefly, I remember it clearly. It started out no different from most nights in Ghana. Me and my mum walking across a grass field to our house in complete darkness. You see, unlike London, where the orange glow of those towering lamps was so frequent that our shadows bounced alongside us freely, never having to hide or disguise themselves under the pitch black blanket of the night sky, Ghana was different. And as me and Mum walked through the grass, the stars were our torches. Thinking back years later, there was a beauty to it that I couldn't articulate at the time. Just me, my mum, the stars. And then came our uninvited guests. At first, I thought my eyes were playing tricks on me when the light streak whizzed past. I searched desperately for the source as another strobe zipped in the air. I gripped my mum's hand tighter as the field began to glow with tiny yellow dots of light. Finally, as though orchestrated by nature, all the flies rose into the field at once. I remember both me and my mum standing in awe as the tiny insects flickered in and out of existence. Harmless fireworks, creating different patterns and decorations in the night. If you are ever in doubt about the beauty of nature, find a place to jam and watch some fireflies twinkle in the dark. No cap, I guarantee it will change your mind. Here's an interesting fact about fireflies. Fireflies have an average lifespan of only 1 to 2 years. Basically, they eat, sleep, beat, reproduce, and then die. Yet, in between that time, their natural ability to shine gives them rare moments of beauty as they poke holes into the darkest layers of the night. For me, there's something very human-like about fireflies. Because no matter how shitty the human race is, you can't deny that in our greatest moments, we can be glorious. Men walking on the surfaces of the moon. Technology that carries our voices across continents. Think about the beauty of cinema. Flickering images that capture the imagination for lifetimes. Or music. Sounds trapped into structures and designs that take you on emotional journeys forever. So many times in human history, we've strived and achieved the impossible. In the darkest moments, we've emerged like fireflies. But also like fireflies, these moments that tend to define us come and can go in an instance. Just like that. Okay, this makes me think about fireflies. Do you think that they know that in only less than 2 years, 760 days max, it will all be over? All their wonder and defiance of everything that's supposed to be possible in nature, only just a blink in existence. I want to turn to the inspiration behind the title of this essay. The 1988 Japanese animated war film, The Grave of Fireflies, based on a short by Akiyuki Nosaka, pronunciation is probably terrible, forgive me, written and directed by Isoa Takahata, and animated by the iconic Studio Ghibli. Not sure how many anime fans here, but I'll explain a bit and try not to digress. Anime is the common name used to refer to the unique Japanese style of animation, typically aimed at adults as well as children. So if you're one of those people that still argue that cartoons are for children, you're an idiot. The average person is probably familiar with the more popular animes like Dragon Ball Z or Pokemon. Now, Studio Ghibli is arguably only behind Disney in creating some of the most legendary, thought-provoking, and culture-shifting animated films. The Grave of Fireflies is no exception. Except for the themes in this one are on the next level. Let me tell you how I ended up watching The Grave of Fireflies, and maybe we'll start getting to a point. A few years ago, my younger sister challenged me. It was a weird challenge. Then again, all big brothers know that all little sisters are weird. Her challenge for me was to watch an anime she'd recently seen and see if I could get through the entire thing without crying. That anime was Grave of Fireflies. In order for this to make sense, I'm going to have to explain a bit about the premises of Grave of Fireflies, and hopefully by the end you understand what it inspired and is relevant to this conversation. Okay, let me give you a bit of a feel of the world that the film takes you to. The film starts with the image of a firefly, before cutting into an opening sequence of a young boy in a soldier's uniform. He's highlighted in a depressing, diluted red and brown hue. Despite the lack of colour, you can see that his uniform is dirty and his face is sullen. Then the film opens with the words, September 1945. That was the night that I died. It then fades out into a location shot where there's another boy leaning against a pillar. He looks about 12, 13. This boy is malnourished. His bones are visible beneath his skin and his clothes are tattered. His breaths are shallow and exaggerated. He's clearly dying from starvation as strangers walk around him. One man questions if he's already dead, while the rest complain about homelessness in Japan. None of them stop to check on the boy. We cut to a close-up of the boy's face, just as the last bits of life are abandoning him. We hear the voice of a child, a young girl. Mama, she shouts, as her words echo in his memory, just as he collapses to the pavement, mumbling, Setsuko, before taking his final breath. A symbolic fly rests itself on his body, and the janitor walks past. He looks at the boy and simply says, another one. That's when the camera pans out and you see there are several other boys, barely teenagers, laying under different pillars in the same station, all of them dead. Bruv, this is less than 2 minutes into the film. Describing Grave of Fireflies as emotional is an understatement. Throughout the film, we follow Sieta and Setsuko, who were orphan refugees in a post-war Japan. After their house is firebombed and their mother dies from severe burns, the film forces you to watch how 14-year-old Sieta struggles to take care of his 4-year-old sister all by himself. An outcome of tragedy is almost inevitable. For those who haven't seen it, I don't want to spoil it, but I highly, highly recommend it. And I'm not gassing either. Legendary critic Roger Ebert included it as one of his list of great films.
A lot of war films, and many of them are exciting or moving or dramatic or artistically effective. And a few of them actually reach you at an emotional level and not just at the action level. I was amazed the first time I saw Grave of the Fireflies to find that I was actually moved just about to tears.
It ranked 12 on Total Film's 50 Greatest Animated Films, and on the People's website, Rotten Tomatoes, it has a reported 98% approval rating, and that's with an average rating of 9.1 out of 10. Then, to legitimize the tragic narrative of the film, Empire Magazine ranked it at number 6 in its list of top 10 depressing movies. So you can imagine, it's a, what's the word? Tearjerker. But despite all these reasons, the main reason this movie in particular inspired this conversation is simple. It's the feeling it gave me when the credits finally rolled. You're left asking the question, why? Why? You watch the film and you ask why. Not why did this have to happen or why did it end like this? It's more like after watching Sieta and Setsuko's journey and struggle, you ask why they even bothered in the first place. All the pain and adversity they fought through, all the hardship and struggle they survived, regardless of how admirable their thrive for survival was. By the end of the film, you're thinking, was there any point to it? Like fireflies, their efforts are constantly extinguished over and over again. And it'd be more comforting to say that, yeah, this is just a film, but it's reality. Some of us have seen it over and over again. Some of us have even lived it. We get back up only to be shoved back into the dirt. Some people have followed all the right paths, but still, why? And I think the answer to the question I asked earlier, why do we matter, lies in here. I want to take you back 10 years ago. The 2008 Beijing Olympics. A 24-year-old Jamaican sprinter by the name of Usain Bolt stepped up to the 200-meter line. Although his name was already regarded as a favourite to win, this was the Olympics. Nothing's ever guaranteed. Until the gun went off. The entire world watches him challenge the impossible and come out victorious. A record that stood for almost 15 years comes crashing down from the heavens into the territories of attainable. In less than 20 seconds, 19:30 to be precise, the world has changed. History rewritten in an instant. Although Bolt would go on to break his record again in the next year, it had taken him years since he was a teenager to capture that first time. That first moment, which evaporated in seconds, flicked on and off like the light of a firefly. I think that's how I've come to rationalize existence. Is it worth spending close to half your life, sometimes your entire life, chasing a moment that will disappear infinitely quicker than it came? I guess if you think about Usain Bolt, it does. Since those moments, when they do come, they freeze time. Sometimes they capture and inspire millions. But most importantly, they live with you forever. Even when someone does eventually break Bolt's record, he's had his moment to pass down to generations and generations. A legacy that matters. But what I think we shouldn't neglect, what really matters before the world record, was the years that he had the purpose. That ambition that carried him from training to training, giving him something to strive for. You see, it doesn't have to be the Olympics. Like Seta and Setsiko, despite the hardship of their struggle, in the grave of fireflies, there were moments they tried, moments they lived, moments that they mattered. In a way, I think we need goals, we need ambitions, we need something that drives us from one moment to the next. They don't have to be world records. It can be as simple as traveling to the outskirts of that underwhelming little town you've lived your whole life and seeing how people live across its borders. Because I realized that it's only in those moments can we experience not just potential disappointment and suffering, but small pockets of hope, love, joy and ambition. Every moment you're alive matters because every moment is an opportunity to experience the joys and sometimes pains of just being human. Do you know how fireflies glow in the dark? Fireflies produce a chemical reaction inside their body that allows them to light up. This type of light production is called bioluminescence. They use this during twilight to attract mates or prey. In other words, fireflies glow to survive. It's in their nature to hang like lamps underneath the stars, even if their fate has already been determined. Even if one or two years they may not be here anymore. I think it's similar to humans. We strive to shine regardless of the fact that death will inevitably have the last say, leaving our lives as nothing more than whispers on the winds of time. If we don't glow, if we don't have those moments, if we don't strive, are we really human? I guess it's human for us to matter. I want to end this with an extract from Carl Sagan, Pale Blue Dot. The Pale Blue Dot is an extract from his book. It's inspired by the image of the Earth taken from a spaceship, the Voyager 1, when it was about 6.4 billion kilometers away in deep space. In the image, the Earth appears as a tiny point of light, a crescent, only 0.12 pixels in size. For me, Sagan's words put a lot of things into perspective. Why, even though our planet or our goals are just a speck of light in the wide universe, why we are so much more. Or maybe why we're not. Ultimately, that's for you to decide. But I'll leave you with his words. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering. Thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines. Every hunter and forager. Every hero and coward. Every creator and destroyer of civilization. Every king and peasant. Every young couple in love. Every mother and father. Hopeful child, inventor, and explorer. Every teacher of morals. Every corrupt politician. Every superstar. Every supreme leader. Every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there. On a mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors so that in glory and triumph they could become momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings, how eager they are to kill one another, how fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusions that we have some privileged position in the universe, a challenge by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great, enveloping cosmic dark.